All right, folks, well, welcome back to day two of the workshop. A quick announcement tonight about dinner. There's no formal dinner organized, but there will be a reception and there'll be food at the reception in the manner of last night. And for those who want to go to dinner afterwards, we'll just have to self-organize. I'm sure we're capable of that. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Russ Poldrack from Stanford this morning. Russ has done lots of great work, as I'm sure many of you know. And as a philosopher, I just want to say how wonderful it is for someone whose work is not only philosophically stimulating, but someone who makes themselves available to philosophers and is willing to come speak to philosophers so readily. So over to you, Russ.
All right. Thanks for having me. Sorry I couldn't be here yesterday. I had to teach on Thursday. But I'm glad I was able to make it now. So thank you all for showing up. So what I'd like you to do first is hop into a time machine with me. We're going to go back to 1890 and talk about what was going on in science in 1890. So what were chemists doing in 1890? They were debating about whether atoms existed. So Ernst Mach, as late as 1897, said, "I do not believe that atoms exist." And so this wasn't really settled until 1905. In biology, people were finally coming to believe that cells existed and that, you know, germs caused disease and it wasn't caused by the miasma. But they still didn't understand how heredity worked. They knew that things were inherited, but Mendel wouldn't be rediscovered for 10 more years. Computers didn't really exist yet, though. I actually didn't know that Hollerith had in 1890 a calculating machine that was sold to the U.S. Census. That worked on these punch cards, but general purpose programming languages wouldn't be discovered or invented for 50 more years. And in neuroscience, right around that time was when Cajal first gave us the evidence for the idea that there were sort of individual cells in the brain called neurons rather than it being kind of one big sort of connected tissue. So what about psychology? So as many of you know, 1890 was the year that William James published his Principles of Psychology. And that book remains as a landmark to psychology. And what's striking is when you look at the topic headings from that book, almost all of them, other than the floweriness of the language, sound like things that could actually be papers from today, right? The neural process, which underlies imagination, forgetting, to what cerebral process is the sense of time due, varieties of attention. None of these sounds like, things from another century, right, even though they were almost a century and a half ago. And so what I want to spend a little bit of time talking about is what does a conceptual revolution look like and how do we think about sort of where psychology is now, especially with respect to these other sciences that have clearly had, we think, conceptual revolutions. And so I want to start by talking about how other parts of the world think about ontology. So many of you are probably familiar with the gene ontology. This has been around, I think they started development in the late 1990s. And basically, this is a formal description of all of the sort of concepts in biology. It has three parts, which are biological processes, things like, MAP kinase cascades, molecular functions like protein complex binding, and cellular components like endoplasmic reticulum. And it defines relationships between all of those things, basically defines a big graph that says, how are all these things related to one another? What's a part of what? What's a kind of what? So this is the current language of biology. And so let's now go back and ask, how does this relate to what people were talking about in 1890? So thanks to Google Books, we can actually access the full text for lots of old books, right? So these are Thomas Huxley's biology book from 1892 and Parker's from 1893. Both of them, neither is as long as James's book, but both are reasonably sort of substantial textbooks, 400 to 500 pages. So if we take the full text and now go in and ask how many of those terms from the gene ontology are actually mentioned in these books, the answer is almost none, right? In fact, it is for molecular functions, it is none, which sort of makes sense. Molecular biology didn't exist then. But for biological processes, it's on the order of 0.1%, and for cellular components, it's about 1%. It's actually pretty consistent across the two books which ones they mention. But the idea is that these books were talking a completely different language from the way that biologists talk now. So how do we do this for psychology? Well, we need a formal ontology, right? So they have gene ontology, we need something like that. So we, about 10 years ago, started developing this thing called the Cognitive Atlas, which is meant to be like the gene ontology for cognitive science and cognitive neuroscience. So the idea is that it's meant to be a collaboratively built ontology that describes what are the things that we think exist in the mind. So here's the way that we chop it up in general. So we make a big distinction between what we call mental concepts, which are psychological functions or processes or representations, sort of things that, you know, latent things that live in the head that we can't see, and tasks, which are the way that we measure them, right? So we have latent constructs, and then we have the tasks that we use to measure them, and we describe various aspects of those tasks, like the experimental conditions, the contrast. In general, we don't look at a single condition and ask, what's going on there. We have to compare between conditions, be that in imaging or behavior. And so the contrast are the things that we focus on being actually the measurements of these latent functions. So for example, we might think that a contrast on, this particular measure in the stop signal task measures the psychological function of response suppression. So we've spent a lot of time trying to go through and annotate the literature. Unfortunately, a lot of the psychological community hasn't sort of bought into this yet, so we haven't had a lot of help from them. So it's involved a lot of it, doing it on our own. So what would this look like? So if you go to, the website is cognitiveatlas.org, it's all openly available. So if you go there and, for example, put in working memory into the search window, you'll get back a list of things that are somehow related to working memory. And if we just go click on the top one, it'll take us to the page describing the concept of working memory. And what that comprises is a definition, a set of relationships. So for example, working memory is a kind of memory. Phonological working memory is a kind of working memory. Rehearsal loop is a part of working memory, and so on. So we try to describe the relationships between these different concepts, which you can think of as basically a graph of relationships. We also then describe all the different tasks that are thought to measure working memory and the particular contrast on those tasks that measures working memory. For example, we think that on a particular operation span task, the person's average operations is some measurement of that construct. So then we can go look at the description of tasks. And one of the things we try to be very careful to do is in defining the task, people will often talk about a working memory task or an attention task. We try to be very clear to not use the psychological constructs as descriptors of the task. So we provide a description of the task, we say what it measures, we actually give pointers to implementations and then describe all of the different aspects of the task that one can ultimately use to link back to data, right? So the big goal here is to be able to link from data via the representation of tasks over to these representations of constructs. And as I hope I'll show you today, we're kind of finally starting to get there. We also kind of bring things together into what we call collections. And there's two types of collections. One is what you can think of as a theory, really a theory. We think of theories in this ontological framework as sort of sets of assertions about relationships, and I'll show you an example. And then we also have, on the task side, what we call task batteries, which are sort of sets of tasks that move together. So for example, the Wechsler Adult Intelligence Scale comprises a bunch of different constituent tasks, and then based on all those tasks together, you can come up with some sort of measurement that you can think of as like a derived measurement across those. Here's an example of a theory. This is Baddeley's model of working memory, and the idea is that this model has a bunch of constituent assertions, like spatial working memory is a kind of working memory, episodic buffer is a part of working memory, and so on. So that set of assertions is a way of expressing that theory. Clearly, it's probably not a powerful enough expressive language to fully capture the theory, but at least it starts to relate theories back to these concepts and then ultimately back to tasks. So, people often use the same term to mean very different things in psychology. Behavioral inhibition is one of my favorite examples, where some people use this term to mean, the ability to stop oneself from doing things. Other people use it in a very different sense to mean sort of this temperamental thing about shyness and, unwillingness to approach new things as a kid. And so we basically have taken kind of clues from Wikipedia and thinking about how to represent these things. So we have what we call disambiguation pages so that you can fork a concept and have different senses of the concept. This isn't meant to really capture disagreement about what the concept means. It's really meant to capture different, completely different uses of the same term. So where is it now? So we have currently 800 constructs, 700 tasks, about 200 disorders, which we've basically pulled in from another ontology, 41 collections. And we have one thing you can do if you have a formal ontology is usually to actually reason. Ours is not at this point, is not a well enough formed ontology to actually do any interesting reasoning over, but we do have an OWL file available if one wanted to do that. And we also have a web API, so if you want to programmatically grab information from the Cognitive Atlas, you can do that via the API. And my grad student built a Python package that makes it pretty easy to actually pull that stuff in. That's what we're using for some of the data mining that I'll show you. So back to William James. How much progress has psychology made? It turns out that 22%-ish of the terms in the Cognitive Atlas actually show up in William James's book. And these are some of the examples, many of which sound like things that people are still studying today, right? So clearly there's been some change, but it seems to be sort of an order of magnitude different from what you see in biology. So that suggests that, you know, we really are relying on a much more similar conceptual framework to William James than other sciences are to their sort of analogous theories from 1890. So another way to ask this question is to look more broadly. I mean, it might, you know, these are just three books, right? So we can also ask just across the entirety of the published literature, to what degree were Cognitive Atlas terms being used, you know, long ago as opposed to other biology terms? And so it turns out that Google has, they've been scanning books for years now, and they have this corpus, the Google Books corpus, with on the order of 3 million books. And you can actually mine them for n-grams, so up to like phrases of length 5. You can basically say across, you know, for every year, how many times did this particular word or set of words show up across all of these books? So this is an example. This is like Frankenstein and Albert Einstein and Sherlock Holmes. You can see sort of when they came in. So what I did was I took the Cognitive Atlas terms and then took the gene ontology terms and compared them in terms of their time course over time. Now, the gene ontology is much bigger than the Cognitive Atlas, and I will be able to go back and do the full gene ontology, but for this talk, I was only able to do a subsample. So basically, I took random samples of gene ontology terms of about the size of the Cognitive Atlas just to give a rough feel. So here's what you see for Cognitive Atlas. And I separated out by the length of the concepts. It turns out that many of the gene ontology concepts are much longer. I think that, you know, we have very few things that are longer than three words and very few concepts that are longer than three words in the Cognitive Atlas, whereas gene ontology has some that are 6, 7, 8 words long. And so I wanted to equate for word length. So this is what you see for the Cognitive Atlas. So basically, for the one word concepts in the Cognitive Atlas, 80% of them were in use in 1800. That's the left cutoff here. And you can see that for the three word ones, they come on, you know, much more recently, such that about a quarter of them are in use by 1950, and now you can find half of them in that literature. For the two word phrases, about half were in use by 1920 something. Okay, so what this suggests is at least for the shorter terms that make up about a third of the Cognitive Atlas or a quarter of the Cognitive Atlas, those are all terms that have basically, it's hard to imagine a better example of a folk term, right, than something that showed up in 1800. Here's what you see for gene ontology. Much less usage of those terms. The biological processes and cellular components terms were both around 20% in 1800, and then they, you know, grow. The molecular function stuff basically was not really in use at all until well into the molecular biology revolution. So this tells you that, you know, we're relying more heavily on folk intuitions and folk concepts than other sciences. So what are the alternatives? Well, it could well be that we just happen to get it right, right? That you know, whereas biology and chemistry, they really needed to go through their, you know, crazy miasma theory and phlogiston and all that stuff, but we just happened to get it right the first time around, and because we have special access. The other alternative is that we're basically, you know, leaning on a set of concepts that can't give us what we need, and until we have a conceptual revolution, there's no way we're going to be able to solve the problems that we want to solve. So the question that I wanted to then ask today is, can neuroscience give us an answer to that? Or can it help us address that challenge? And Mike, I think, mentioned the phrenology thought experiment yesterday. I'm going to show kind of a different version of it. So I like to do the thought of experiment of, you know, what if phrenologists had fMRI? What would they do? And in particular, would fMRI be useful in helping them figure out, you know, whether their ontology, which is these, you know, faculties that none of us now think are sort of natural kinds of the mind, would it have helped them get around that or not? So let's say that, you know, phrenologist X gets their hands on a fMRI scanning environment, and they're really interested in benevolence, right? Then they're you know, running the laboratory for benevolence. And so what they would do is they do a subtraction study where they show some people who are highly benevolent and some people who are not very benevolent. And you know, what would happen, right? You know what would happen. They would find a blob and they would publish a paper on the neural basis of benevolence, right? And then somebody would come along and build phrenosynth, okay? So they would take all the phrenology results and say, you know, what turns on for suavity and causality and human nature and language? And then they would start to realize that, hey, you know, we're seeing all the same areas showing up for all these different phrenological concepts. What could that mean? You probably see where this is going. These are actually real data from neurosynth, which you've probably heard a bit about. I know you're going to hear more about. It turns out that if we look at what areas turn on for lots of, you know, in association with lots of different psychological concepts, you see a number of areas that some people have come to call multiple demand systems that basically turn on for lots of different stuff. And the question is, what do we make of that? And I think that what this highlights is the deficiency of the way that we generally do imaging. So the way that I think of the standard approach to imaging is sort of finding neural correlates of X. So the idea is that we wiggle something in the mind and we look at what wiggles in the brain, right? So I manipulate working memory maintenance and I see which regions move around. What does that tell me? It tells me that working memory is sufficient to cause activity in that particular area. Nothing more than that. It doesn't tell me that working memory is necessary, and it doesn't tell me that that region is necessary or sufficient for that particular function. And we know actually of lots of examples where you can see an area that lights up for a task, you lesion that area, or you find a person with a lesion in that area, they can still do the task perfectly fine. How many of you know this paper? You can't play 20 questions with nature and win. So this is an awesome paper by Alan Newell that was written around like the time of kind of, you know, early cognitive psychology. It was at a conference in 1973, and he basically tried to make the point about psychology at that point, which he sort of accused of playing 20 questions with nature and win, and playing 20 questions with nature, and claimed that one cannot win that game. He lays out this thought experiment basically saying, I'm going to take one of you from the audience and sort of, you know, who's been publishing lots, and I'm going to take Rodri and project out all of his papers over the next 30 years and say, what will those 30 years worth of papers tell us that we don't already know, and how will they help us solve? I mean, he has this great line, will we have achieved a science of man adequate in power and commensurate with his complexity? And I think we could easily ask the same thing about all the papers that I've published, or for those of us who do imaging in this room, almost all the empirical papers that any of us has published. Can we project out 30 years and think of how it is that a bunch more experiments, you know, asking in questions about what lights up particular parts of the brain, or what causes representational changes in different parts of the brain, you know, frame it however you want, how those are going to really allow us to understand the functions of neural systems that end up driving cognition. So Tal Yarkoni and I, in a recent paper, have argued that one way to address this is to kind of flip the way that we are addressing the question. So the idea is that instead of, you know, saying, I'm going to wiggle this and see what moves in the brain, and then I'm going to wiggle this, and then I'm going to wiggle this, the idea is that we manipulate a bunch of things. And in general, this is going to require getting data from lots of people wiggling those things because, you know, no individual lab is going to go do everything. And then try to understand what we can actually selectively infer about individual functions from brain activity. So the idea is that instead of, you know, finding out what causes different parts of the brain to move, we figure out what can we actually predict from the activity of particular brain areas. And that provides us with a stronger way of inferring the function of those areas. So we started doing this a few years ago, a paper that I had with Steve Hansen and Yara Kalchenko, which looked at whether we could basically take people performing one of a number of different tasks. In this case, it was eight different tasks. And we build a classifier to basically say, can we take your pattern of brain activity for a particular task, just compared to doing nothing, and then using a classifier trained on other people doing all those eight tasks, can we predict which of them you're doing? And the answer is pretty well, yes. We can, you know, for most tasks, we get about 70 to 80% accuracy on our ability to predict whether you're doing that task or not. And we've since, in our open fMRI paper, we pushed that out to a 26-way classification. So we're trying to, that's with 300-something people. And there we can get up to about 50% accuracy, clearly much better than chance, but you know, nowhere near perfect. And interestingly, it seems like we're relying on fairly low dimensional information in the brain because we can do dimensionality reduction down to about, certainly, you know, down to 100 components, and we'd actually do pretty well even going down to 10 components, you know, projecting the brain data down into 10 numbers and still do pretty well. But it's not tasks that we ultimately want to decode, it's cognitive functions, right? So what I'd like to, holy grail is to be able to take an image, like an activity map of the brain, and be able to say not what task are you doing, but what cognitive functions were engaged when that, you know, in the context of that image, even if it's a task we've never seen before. So I'd like to be able to generalize not just to new people, but also to new tasks. The way that we have tried to do that first started with some work by Sanmi Koyajo, who was he's a research scientist in my lab, which he basically took the same data that we had shown here, this 26 task data, and then we went through for each of those data sets, each of the contrasts that was being imaged there, and sort of coded them in terms of this really rough ontology. This is an ontology that's taken from the brain map, which is a database, which is one of these meta-analytic databases. This is the way that they code things. You can see it's a pretty coarse coding of psychological functions, much coarser than the cognitive atlas. So what we do is we code the data set using that coarse set of terms. And then we basically say, can we predict using a multi-label classification? So multi-label is basically a classifier that tries to predict which of, you know, n labels is there for each data set, where each one can have, you know, any number of those present. And so it turns out, you know, that's a pretty substantially difficult classification problem. He looked at various techniques and found that at least for the very common functions, we could actually do reasonably well at predicting the presence of those terms, though not amazingly well. You know, at best, we're 50%-ish. At least suggests that there might be some ability to go and do this. But, you know, one, we had a limited number of cognitive tasks there, and, you know, it was just 26 contrasts, and the annotation was really coarse. So what we've been doing in the last little while now is trying to basically improve on that by increasing the number of tasks and improving the annotation. And one of the ways that we're trying to do that is by using shared data. So the open fMRI data set is a shared data set. A lot of it actually comes from my lab. But we've also been trying to look at using other types of data. So, you know, open fMRI is a project that involves sharing of complete raw fMRI data sets, you know, every image from every subject. That's a challenging problem because it's, you know, they're big, there's lots of data there, and there's lots of metadata that you need in order to specify how to analyze those data. There's certain things for which, you know, you really want that. And we've seen, you know, particularly in the context of the Human Connectome Project, which has been sharing, you know, raw data for the last few years, that's been really revolutionary in terms of, you know, giving people really good data sets to go do interesting analyses with. But getting people to share raw data is challenging. I mean, OpenFMRI has been around for at least online for at least 8 years, I think, and, you know, we have 40-something data sets right now. It's growing finally, but still, it's, you know, you can't expect to get a lot in when you're asking people to put in full data sets. So one thing that we've been interested in is seeing the degree to which we can maybe lower the bar to data sharing and make it easier for people to give us data that will nonetheless be useful. And so one idea is that instead of asking people to share their complete raw data sets, we just ask them to share the results from those studies. So in an imaging study, the results are whole brain statistical maps, where at every, you know, point in the brain you have a statistic value that says, you know, how much was this particular area activated by that particular task contrast. And so this is what the NeuroVault project does. Whereas, you know, the other ways that have been really successful for sharing data are just basically telling me where did the activation happen, right? I'm going to talk about NeuroSynth in a bit. NeuroSynth just focuses on sharing or harvesting of activation coordinates. So you can think of sort of this pyramid as a spectrum of potential reuse, but also a spectrum of sort of sparsity, right? That where at the top, you're really sparse in terms of the information you're getting. As you go down, you're getting more and more information. So NeuroVault is a project that Chris Gorgolewski in my lab started a couple of years ago that basically gives people the ability to easily upload statistical maps from imaging studies. And I think it now has several hundred collections where people can do it either publicly or privately. So if somebody just wants to show images to their friend across the world, they can upload the data and then show it to them. But we, by default, make the stuff public. And it's amazing how powerful defaults are, because almost everybody goes with that. So this is at neurovault.org if you want to poke around. And all the data are, you know, publicly available. You can download them and meta-analyze them. And so what we did was we spent a number of months going through, and we basically found a bunch of data sets that we thought were relevant that we tried to span as much of the psychological space as we can, though clearly we haven't spanned it fully. And we went through and basically took each of the contrast maps and tried to go through and annotate each contrast using the cognitive atlas. So in, you know, so this is what you see if you go to NeuroVault. You see an activation image that's thresholded, and it says this is for this particular task, for this particular contrast. And you can't see this, but if you dig into the details, it'll basically have a link down here to the cognitive atlas. So this particular contrast has an identifier in the cognitive atlas, and this links to it. So then what we can do is go into the, you know, we have a programmatic link to the cognitive atlas, and we can then basically by doing cognitive psychology, by sitting down, analyzing that task and saying, what psychological functions do we think are being manipulated by this particular task. And so for this particular contrast, it might be risk and reward anticipation and response execution and some number of others. I think each contrast has on average 8 or so functions that it's annotated with. And so then in the context of doing this, we also tried to build out the cognitive atlas as much as we could in terms of specifying the relationships between concepts. When we started the atlas, a lot of it was just about getting the concepts in, like figuring out what are the things. And now I think we have a pretty good handle, to at least to some degree, on what are the things. Now the question is, how are the things related to one another? What's a kind of what? What's a part of what? So we've, in the last year, done a lot of work both with this annotation and then also kind of fleshing out that ontology. Obviously, it's, you know, most of the work's been done by my lab, and so it's a very, you know, sort of limited view of the state of psychology, but this is open to anybody to get involved in. So the hope is that you know, people will get pissed by what we did and go in and try to fix it. So the first thing that this allows us to ask is a very global question, which was, does image similarity relate to ontological similarity? And so it turns out that people in the bioinformatics literature have developed ways of quantifying ontological similarity in the context of the gene ontology. So the idea is that, you know, you when things are related in the graph, they sort of share some degree of similarity. And the assumption that this Wang approach made, which you can argue with or not, is that you know, that ISA relationships have a weight of 0.8, part-ofs have a weight of 0.6. So the idea is that you basically, for example, if I want to know the similarity between auditory sentence recognition and sentence recognition, that's one step here, that's 0.8. Between auditory sentence recognition and sentence processing, that's two ISA steps, so that's 0.64. So basically, you just go through the graph and multiply edges to get the similarity. Now, you know, in general, for any particular task contrast, we're going to have a number of different concepts. You have, you know, different parts of the graph. And so so what you do there is basically you just take, for each one, you take sort of the maximum similarity between each element and in one graph and all the elements in the other. And so what that does is gives you for any pair of sets of concepts, right? So here I have one that's, you know, maybe auditory sentence processing and response inhibition, and here I have one that's auditory, lexical processing and response inhibition. We can compute the similarity of those based on the ontology, and then ask, if we then take the images that were associated with them, and then just do a very simple Pearson correlation between those images to get their similarity, how does that relate? And it turns out that over all of these pairs, so each dot here is a pair of images. There were 93, so it's 93 times 92 divided by 2 of those pairs. And so you see that there's a reasonable correlation actually between ontological similarity and image similarity, such that things that are close to one another in the ontology seem to also have images that are close to one another, suggesting we're capturing something interesting. So what we've then tried to do is kind of move forward from, you know, I showed you this multi-label classifier idea for kind of trying to decode cognitive functions. And one thing that doesn't give you is a very interpretable basis for the classification. And so what we've been doing now is building what are called encoding models to try to better understand not just how well can we decode, but what's the basis for that decoding. So the way that an encoding model is actually really simple. The idea is that you do this separately at every voxel. You, for each voxel, take its response. So in this case, it would be, you know, across those 93 different tasks, task contrast, you would take the voxel's response for each of those. And you fit a linear model where the rows in the linear model are just each of the task contrast, and the columns are basically an indicator saying, does this task involve this particular psychological function? So basically, every column here is a cognitive atlas concept. And so the indicators there are based on, you know, our saying whether or not there's a link between the task contrast and the cognitive concept. And we basically just fit a linear model. Now, because it's wider than it is tall, we have to do that using regularized regression. In this case, we used elastic net, which gives you some degree of sparsity. And so that's the way we first build the model. And the question is now, how do you decode based on that model? And the idea is that you really sort of just turn it around and use it as a generative model. So what we do is we take our full data set and then we leave two images out. Okay, so we have those 93 images, we leave two out, we take the remaining 91 and we train this model. And then for the two that were left out, which, you know, don't necessarily have to be the same task that were in that training set of 91, they just need to have some overlapping cognitive concepts. You basically predict what would the value be at every voxel for a task that had this particular set of cognitive concepts, right? So we're just basically projecting what would that image look like. And this is based on a trick that Tom Mitchell developed a long time ago in his classifier work with language. And then what we do is we just compare the predicted images to the actual images for those two tasks. And accuracy is basically determined by whether, you know, if, you know, predicted image one is closer to task one and predicted image two is closer to task two. And so that's it's a really simple way of trying to do decoding that also gives you some degree of sort of interpretability. So it turns out that we had five tasks that, because of the sparsity, ended up having basically emptied the classifier predicted no activity at all. So we couldn't use those. For the remaining ones, we actually do pretty well. We get 81% correct classification, suggesting, you know, which is pretty surprising given that we're generalizing across, you know, all kinds of differences in scanners and group sizes, because these are all, you know, group activity maps that anybody could have uploaded. I mean, we didn't care where they came from as long as they were whole brain maps and they had a task that we thought we could understand. And so the nice thing about these encoding models is that we can now go back and look at what's the support for the encoding. What do the maps look like? And what's interesting is some of the maps look very reasonable and some of them look completely unlike what you would expect. So for example, the attention one, you know, you get a bunch of stuff in occipital, parietal cortex, lateral prefrontal cortex. The error detection one, you know, you get a bunch of medial prefrontal stuff and posterior cingulate. The face recognition one is interesting because, this is hard to see, but you don't actually get fusiform gyrus. You get this more lateral temporal region. What that means, I'm not sure. And then you get some that make no sense at all, like language comprehension, you actually get very little coming up. And obviously there's a lot of reasons why these things might or might not match what we expect. One is that, you know, the data are crappy. We don't have enough tasks for that concept or so on. The other is that, you know, that we're sort of conceptualizing things in a way that doesn't fit with how the data actually match the concepts. We can also look at, if we take each term and look at across all the images that term was associated with, how accurate were we? We can see that terms differ substantially in, in how accurately we can predict them. So response execution presumably should be a pretty easy one because almost all those are going to be, you know, things up around the motor strip. And so that's something that we should be able to classify pretty well. And some actually are pretty detailed and yet surprising, like working memory maintenance, we can actually do fairly well at. I threw out anything that had fewer than 10 images associated with it because I figured we need a decent amount of data to be able to assess this accuracy. But interestingly, some with a good number, like cognitive control, actually we can't do that well on. And this fits with, I think you talked about the Leonardowitz stuff yesterday, suggesting that some of these, you know, cognitive control terms, we didn't have task switching in here, which was one of the ones that really failed in the Leonardowitz study. But the idea is that we can start using this now to try to get a feel. Obviously, if we had something that came in at 50%, that would lead us to think that we really need to rethink either the data that are associated with that concept or the ontological status of that concept. So we can also ask, you know, what happens if we try to trade quantity for quality? So I mentioned neurosynth earlier. So what neurosynth is a system built by Taliercone that goes into the literature and automatically extracts the activation coordinates that are usually put into imaging papers. So the idea is we report these little XYZ coordinates to say roughly where in the brain was activation. So it's basically just a high degree of sparsification of a full brain activation map. The nice thing is that because you can do it automatically, he has data for, you know, 400 something thousand activations from over 11,000 papers. So he can basically, for most journals, he can go in and just automatically pull things out. And so now the question is, can we do something similar, but instead of using, obviously now, you know, those, we can't go in and sort of code each of those 11,000 things using the cognitive atlas. But what we can do is use as a proxy the presence of the cognitive atlas term in the abstract of the paper. And so we did that. We took all the cognitive atlas terms and mapped them against publications and then looked at how well we can predict. And it turns out even here we can do pretty well. Unfortunately, my student wasn't able to get the confusion matrices and the images done, so I can't actually tell you which ones we're doing better or worse on, but I'll... hopefully you'll see it sometime soon. But I think that's going to be another sort of potentially interesting way to think about trying to address this question. Another thing that we think is ultimately the right way to answer these types of questions is by sort of jointly modeling the conceptual side and the imaging side. And so we did some work a few years ago using what we call topic mapping, where we did topic modeling on the text using cognitive atlas terms and then try to map that onto the brain. Tim Rubin and Tal and Sammy Koyajo and I have been working on recently is an approach that sort of tries to use a topic modeling approach that puts together both imaging data and the terms from the paper. This is this thing called generalized correspondence, LDA, and it actually, in order to make it more tractable, it models the activations as a mixture of bilaterally symmetric Gaussians. This is some of the early results from this, basically just showing that it does a pretty good job of pulling out sets of areas and concepts that at least make sense in terms of moving together. You know, that you get this MT-looking thing for visual motion perception, you get ventral striatum for monetary reward, you get medial temporal lobe for memory associative novel. So it basically just says that, look, there's a lot of really useful information that can at least capture our intuitions. And now the question is, how can we push this in terms of trying to figure out, you know, which terms do the best job of, you know, sort of disambiguating between different regions? And that is another way we think that we can sort of, you know, go forward in trying to understand the ontological, the neural reality of some of these terms in our ontologies. So, you know, ultimately neurosynth is fundamentally limited, right? We're never going to be able to answer all the questions we want to answer by using, you know, a few activation coordinates. So to solve, so I think, you know, I think I said to Tim last night, I feel like this program of research has been a successively slightly more plausible set of proofs of concept. And what I've shown you today is the latest proof of concept that still isn't where we want to be. You know, if we had, you know, data from every study that's published across, you know, every different cognitive task that people have ever thought of, and we had each of those annotated by an expert using, you know, something like the cognitive atlas, then I think we could actually start to try to feel like we have a good handle on answering these questions, or at least it would tell us, you know, it would give us good candidates for ontological, you know, exclusion or ontological approval. But, you know, we're still in a data limited phase, right? 93 images is clearly not enough to answer this question. So if we had thousands, I think we could start to get there. So we need, you know, everybody's data needs to be shared. Everybody's data needs to be richly annotated with something like the cognitive atlas. And then we still need more powerful models as well. And I think that's, you know, there's so much going on in machine learning right now that that's not going to be a problem other than sort of, you know, getting our heads around them and getting them applied. So here's kind of the ultimate goal of how I think about using imaging data to test ontologies. And we have some ongoing work that's going to try to do this in a limited domain, but I'm going to flesh out kind of the overall vision, which is, you know, I have a bunch of tasks, and for each of those tasks, for some particular contrast on those tasks, I have an activation map, right, for a person or a group or whatever. And let's say I have two ontologies, right? Person one thinks that, you know, that these two particular tasks are reflecting some cognitive function that we call inhibition, and the other two are reflecting something that we call updating, right? But, and those imply a particular covariance structure across the task, right? They imply that the maps for these two tasks should be more highly correlated with each other than the others, and the maps for these two tasks should be more highly correlated with each other. But, you know, person Y might think, oh, I don't believe all those, you know, that multiple systems mumbo jumbo, it's all one thing. And that implies also a particular covariance structure. And, you know, we have methods like meta-analytic structural equation modeling to actually test that and say which of the predicted covariance structures is closest to what we actually see in the data. That can actually help us understand, you know, or at least provide some sort of handle on which of those ontological frameworks we think better describes the neural data. So, to wrap up, I think we're gambling on the validity of a very old ontology, and that gamble may pay off, it may not. I think neuroscience is one way that we can think about testing these things, but I don't think that the current sort of 20 questions approach is going to get us there. And ultimately, you know, we're going to be data limited for a long time, I think, but the hope is that once we get enough data that's annotated, that we can actually start to answer these questions. It's worked in, you know, molecular biology. There's no reason it can't, in principle, work for us. So just finally want to thank the people who've worked on this, particularly Vanessa and Sanmi, and then Tal and Bob Builder, who started the Cognitive Atlas with me. And thank you. This is the pairwise comparison.
Okay.
This. Okay. Yeah.
So just to clarify, the 81% correct classification, is that still doing, you know, two images and
yep.
doing the one that was incorrect more likely than the other?
Exactly. Yeah.
So
for all possible pairs of images.
So that. The 81% is a high number, but it would be more impressive if it was picking out the one that's paired out of all 88 rather than just.
Yes, indeed. So right. Yeah, we've taken a big multi-label problem and turned it into a simple two-choice classification. What we've been trying to do, and this is still in progress, so it wasn't ready to talk about, is you can also basically build like a naive Bayes classifier to predict for each term, is it present, right? So that's what you want, right? You want me to say, for this image, there's concepts A, B, C, D, E.
What I wanted is just to know what would failure look like? What kind of numbers would you
Failure would look like 50% here. Yeah. And that's what, when the null model, if you do this, if you randomly shuffle the, when I say null model, what I mean is we go through and randomly shuffle the labels and then look at what performance is there, and it's on average like 49%, and it never, you know, you look at the entire distribution and you do that 1,000 times, look at the entire distribution, it never gets above like 55%. And so we're way above what you'd expect by chance, but that doesn't mean, I mean, that's a pretty weak sense of victory, right?
Yeah, I just want to get a sense of what would convince me that
if this didn't work at all, then one conclusion would be, probably the best conclusion would be, I don't know what I'm doing. If once we figured out that I knew what I was doing, one conclusion could be that, well, the whole ontology is screwed. But, you know, clearly the whole ontology is not screwed. The question is which parts of it are, you know, kind of useful and which aren't. So that's you know, from my standpoint, this is kind of like the omnibus test, and I don't think the omnibus test is that sort of interesting or useful. For me, what's really more interesting and useful is where does it, you know, what breaks down, what's relatively good and what's relatively bad, and then we can think about, you know, pushing harder on those particular things.
So thinking broadly, it seems to me that your various data sharing programs, are you trying to get neuroscientists to do something like on the scale of the human genome in biology so that all of the data can be pulled together, processed?
Yeah, that would be the holy grail. Unfortunately, you know, we don't have the resources. So, for example, you know, GenBank is the system that's run by the National Library of Medicine, that anybody who publishes a genetic sequence has to upload their data into that database, right? The journals all agree they won't publish papers unless somebody's uploaded their sequence. We don't have anything like that for imaging data. You know, we have OpenFMRI, which is run on pretty much a shoestring, you know, as opposed to the tens of millions of dollars that GenBank has from National Library of Medicine. And the NIH and other institutes aren't interested in running, you know, data sharing banks for imaging. So it's going to be challenging. I think it's also the case that, you know, what we're doing is so much farther from the kind of sales pitch that you can give for the Human Genome Project, right? You know, say we're going to use it to cure cancer. You know, this stuff is not going to cure cancer, right? Not for a while, at least.
Yes, thank you. I wanted to ask if you saw in the beginning, you know, if you see any benefit in holding on to the earlier ontology terms in psychology, I was thinking parallel with what you said about genes and how a lot of the modern debates that we're having are very, you know, ego, devo, and things like that are very similar to debates that, you know, Owen, Mivart, Goldschmidt, and others. And one of the difficulties is that work has such a different ontology or ontological terms that it's difficult to compare the work, and it's difficult to see this kind of larger continuity of similar biological questions. So I was curious if you see from like a research point of view or kind of a community point of view if there's actually any benefit to holding on to some earlier ontological terminology in order to see this kind of continuity of the research questions forming, and if there's any benefit to that.
Interesting question. I mean, it's clear there's a cognitive benefit for us as scientists, right? To be able to kind of map what, you know, what people talk about and what we've always thought about onto neural systems. I guess the concern is, you know, so would, do you think, let's rephrase that question, do you think that it's useful do you think it's useful for neuroscientists to talk about the syncytium of the brain, right? Of all this, you know, big unconnected tissue as opposed to neurons, right? That's a way in which, you know, there was an ontological change, and it's not clear that, you know, the old term is really that useful. Similarly for, you know, other examples of this sort of conceptual change. But presumably, when people were doing science at the time, they had to be able to talk about them both in order to make the transition. Even though, you know, now we don't talk about miasma theory. Presumably, the germ theory people had to talk a lot about miasma theory to kind of relate, you know, what they were doing to that theory. That's my guess. I'm not a historian of science, but yeah, Lisa.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a comment on that. So I would argue that actually the ontology isn't correct, we want to get rid of it. So you look at the way people do their experiments, they're often so constrained by their sort of mental concepts about these different constructs that they design their experiments, they design their stimuli, all in a way that's completely biased by this potentially false ontology. So I think I don't think there's much value in preserving the historical ontology if it's
right. I wouldn't argue with that.
Sorry, and then
Blue. Oh, hi. I had a question about this assessing tests for word use and similar ontologies tests. I'm wondering if you learned in your data sets, because I was thinking these psychological concepts in particular are really, really popular outside of scientific context, right? So you would expect to find pretty strong trends in like words that we use.
Right. That, in part, that's the point, right?
Yeah, but I suppose I was thinking, like, you know, biologists just, as a matter of fact, aren't typically going to have the problem where, like, lots of people are talking about complex biological concepts at the dinner table.
Yeah.
But psychologists don't have this problem. That doesn't necessarily mean that psychologists and cognitive scientists trained in psychology and cognitive science will necessarily use the, like, tabletop versions of things. I mean, I can say this, like, as a philosopher, I mean, there are lots of terms that we use philosophy that has specialized uses, and you'll find lots of them going back many thousands of years, but it's not like if you're a philosopher, you're using them in the same way that other people are using them. And that might be important to thinking about ontological questions. Anyway, that's why I was asking about limiting the data set, because I would think, like, I have a working hypothesis that maybe you limited the data set to just, say, journals and scientific contexts.
If it were possible to do that with Google Ngrams, I would do it, but it's not. So I would have to go back and actually. I mean, that, you know, in part we see that just by comparing those individual texts, right? James versus the other two. But I mean, your point is well taken, right? But it sort of gets back to the point I was making that, you know, the first question is, you know, do we think that psychologists, that professional, you know, experimental psychologists are using these terms differently than people on the street? I'm less convinced than you are that they're distinct. And then the other question is, you know, is it a problem that we're using those? And that's, I think, an empirical question.
So you said one holy grail would be being able to predict the labels from the images. One of the cool things you mentioned, Tom Mitchell's work, one of the cool things he did in his language work is he actually extracted semantic features shared between different labels.
Yep.
And used the semantic features to predict images based on untrained words. Are there any prospects for that in this?
It's interesting. We could, in principle, do some kind of dimensionality reduction on, you know, the cognitive atlas functions. I think that, you know, he had the benefit of having this huge corpus to actually do the SVD on, right, to get the lower dimensional representation. I'm not sure I would really trust, you know, a dimensionally reduced version of this, but it's an interesting question. Yeah, how far down could we reduce it? And to some degree, that's the thing that the, I think one thing we want to do is take that LDA approach and apply it to real data as opposed to the neurosynth data, because that's the kind of place where we could start to get a handle on those sort of things, I think.
Got 5 minutes. Try and get two more questions.
Yeah, I mean, this brings up an interesting question. One of the things that we've been thinking about as it's a pie in the sky, you know, sort of use case, but you can imagine that one thing that this kind of approach can do can tell you what's the right next experiment to go do to pull apart, you know, where, you know, for example, where in the covariance matrix do you have the greatest uncertainty, and, you know, thus, what experiment could you go do to actually kind of, you know, improve that uncertainty, kind of taking some of these sort of, adaptive experimental design ideas. I don't think it's something that we're going to be able to do in the next little while, but I agree that that's a potentially interesting way to think about it.
I'm wondering if there are differences between, if you look at the history of biology versus what's going on in neuroscience, that there are certain different kinds of obstacles that are operating here. And one of them, I think, seems to be that, researchers in this area, there's some flexibility in terms of how they design experiments and how they operationalize their terms, what the tasks look like. And I'm wondering if that variability, if you think that that's a challenge for this, if it's going to involve more than just bringing all this data together, if it's going to involve the field really kind of everybody getting on board with how they're defining their terms and how they're operationalizing those terms.
Yep.
And in some ways, this looks like it could be a solution we can get around these sorts of problems, but do you think that that's a problem that needs to be solved before, or is it not a problem?
No, I think it's definitely a problem.
And you pointed it out in your own work.
Right.
You talk about how a lot of people who are in neuroscience aren't trained as psychologists necessarily, so they don't engage in task analysis,
right.
And so there's just variation in terms of what people are trained.
No, it's definitely a problem, and I'm not sure exactly what the right answer is, but clearly part of the right answer is, you know, being more, having people in general be more thoughtful about decomposing the tasks that they're using. And I mean, it's not to say that the cognitive atlas is the only way that one might decompose it. You know, you might have, actually, one really interesting question is, you know, there's a lot of people who are thinking about, you know, computational models for cognition. You might imagine that there's a whole sort of, you know, computational ontology that one might develop that would frame these things in terms of, you know, completely different terminologies. That might be, you know, the close to the degree that we can think about sort of, you know, a completely different, you know, if we want to, you know, completely eliminate folk psychology and go to a new ontology, I think the best alternative there is really kind of a computational level, you know, not computational level in the Marsons, but a computational psychological ontology that describes, you know, everything in terms of fundamental computational operations. But I totally agree that, you know, the way that we're doing it now is basically just kind of keeping us stuck in the mud.
This seems like a good place. Let's take a 5 minute comfort break and then we'll have research.